Thanks, Alex, and a very good introduction with the previous two speakers. I always enjoy Pia's, I guess, vision of government as an API, and I'm looking forward to being able to hook into it. So I thought I'd just take a few moments just to talk a little bit about really a follow-on from, you know, really leveraging data and how data is being leveraged by predominantly the private sector today, but where there's enormous opportunity in government as well. And this is something that we do at Ambiata day in, day out, and I'm going to really describe that, you know, in the best possible terms that I can. But before I do that, I should just mention that Ambiata is actually a spin out of NICTA, which is proudly providing the venue today. NICTA's generated a number of spin outs throughout its lifetime to date, and I guess we are one of those spin outs, which is now a very active, growing business outside of, I guess, the lab. So I'd like, you know, to sort of acknowledge, you know, our roots within NICTA and something that we're very proud to be alumni of. So this particular talk is entitled The Age of the Individual, and I've actually inserted AI there for a reason, because it's ultimately leveraging a lot of the techniques in machine learning, which is very central to AI, to really enable us to bring personalization or bring personal customer experience to the individual. And so this is what I'm going to talk about. And I think the best way to start is to have a look at really how medicine, okay, has evolved over the last 100 years and how now we're going to see personalised medicine, because it's a very good you know, case study or analogy for how this is actually being applied to individual customer experience or interaction experience, you know, more broadly across all industry as well as government. So if you think about data and science, and this is really where data science comes from, data and science together have actually been helping us for many, many years. And to really understand and see how that's actually happened, let's sort of take a step back about 100 years ago and look at what medicine was like back then. And it, for most people, it actually looked like this. You know, it would be the elixir or the tonic that you'd buy at the market from, you know, maybe the eccentric person who told you that they could cure any ailment that you possibly had, that cough that wouldn't go away, would go away with the syrup. And you just had to pay the money and you'd be cured. Of course, back then there was a lot of faith, a lot of trust, probably a lot of hope that, you know, it would reach a cure, but the reality is that it probably didn't have any scientific basis behind it, okay? Just a lot of herbal sort of tonics all mixed together. And so if you think about medicine today is very much based on science. And one of the key aspects of science is this concept of experimentation. Okay, so science is actually about conducting very precise experiments, observing the outcome, and then making hypotheses from those, and then conducting further experiments potentially to test those hypotheses. So if you have a look at how modern medicine works, it starts off with research where we're looking for correlations in nature. And based on those correlations in nature, we innovate new drugs or new treatments. Okay. And then what we do is we actually take those innovations and we actually test them in the real world by conducting very precise experiments, okay? We call these experiments randomized control trials because of the fact that there's a random component to them to actually be able to abstract away any sort of prejudice or any bias that we may bring into that experiment. And by monitoring those outcomes of those experiments, we're actually able to work out what works and for who, okay, and what doesn't work. But of course, you know, these are more or less pretty blunt instruments. And if you look at medicine today, when you go to a doctor with an infection, he would prescribe you with an antibiotic which is likely to work, okay? He doesn't actually know whether you're going to actually be responsive to that antibiotic. He doesn't understand whether the actual bug has you know, mutated and is resistant to that antibiotic. He or she just prescribes that antibiotic in the hope that it will work. And the randomized control trials have told us that probably in about 80% of the cases it does work. And so therefore, most of us are here today. If it wasn't for randomized control trials and these experimental outcomes, most of the people in this room will probably be dead by now, because, you know, we're probably old enough to have, you know, suffered an infection which would have killed us without antibiotics. So the future is very much about big data. We've heard this buzzword a lot, and it probably means a lot of different things to different people, but I would like to just sort of tell you what it actually means in terms of personalization. So big data is about being able to collect, extract, and process large amounts of data at scale, okay? And what that enables us to do, and if you know, medicine's a really good case study to this. So today, if you look at the cost of genome sequencing, it's been going down by several orders of magnitude every year. So I actually got my genome partially sequenced for about $300 2 years ago, and fully sequenced for about $2,000 today. So you know, that's really making it extremely accessible. And there will be a day in the next few years when you'll be able to actually inevitably get your genome sequenced, you know, for maybe, you know, tens of dollars. And so once we can do that, we get, you know, the billions of base pairs that describe our genetic sequence. And these base pairs tell us a lot about certain types of medication and what medications will be receptive to and will respond positively to. Okay. So once we do that, once we do that, what that enables us to then do is it enables us to actually conduct randomized control trials across the entire human population, which is several billions of people, okay, and actually have a look at, you know, what medications do work and what medications don't work for certain individuals, and then use machine learning to actually identify specific patterns in this sequence which could be predictive or correlated with what's working or what's not working, okay? And because we are conducting randomized control trials, what that enables us to then do is a concept of causal inference. Causal inference is this concept that we can attribute the cause of something happening, you know, to a particular set of features, for example, in this case, in our genetic sequence, okay? So we know that these two individuals had the same illness. One took medication, one didn't take medication, and they had certain patterns within their DNA, then we can say, well, the only difference was the treatment, and so we can then, do causal inference and infer that it must be the medication that actually made that person, you know, be relieved of that particular ailment. And so this concept of personalization, which comes into medicine, is really the combination of a number of things. The first thing is big data, the ability to build a very detailed fingerprint of an individual. Secondly, the ability to experiment at scale. And thirdly, the ability to learn the outcomes of those experiments and correlate it with that detailed behavioral fingerprint. So data scientists today really are applying it to medicine, of course, and personalized medicine. It's certainly a flourishing and growing area. But we are actively applying this to how we individuals interact with companies and how they receive a very personalized treatment to drive a particular outcome, okay? And so you're all familiar with this because you actually experience this every day. Every time you use Google as a search engine, it's actually done this. It's conducted experiments in what search results it returns and actually learned from that and learned from all of your browsing history, everything that it knows about you as an individual to understand what's most likely going to be relevant to you. And if you cast your mind back 10 or 15 years before Google was really the most common search engine, back then it took many, many pages of search results to actually find something that was useful. And the way Google does this and the way we actually do this is we essentially collect anonymized data, or we collect data from multiple different sources. So if we look at any of our clients in the private sector, you know, that may be demographic profile information, maybe all of the interactions that people make across all channels, whether they be digital web channels or telephony channels in branch, whatever it may be. Collect all of those interactions, all of the transactions, so any transactions that occurs, any payment of bills or any financial transactions, of course, or any sort of digital behavior on other sort of digital devices like mobile devices, previous interventions that we may have made to you and how you responded to those interventions. We collect all of that data, and what we do is we actually map that to individuals and create a fingerprint, kind of like a DNA, a behavioral DNA about an individual. And so our behavioral DNA that describes an individual, which is comprised of all these data sources, has millions of attributes that describe everything from how often you may have visited a branch, how often you may have called into a call center on a Monday morning versus a lunchtime versus a weekend, which tells us a lot about the individual. You know, are they time poor? Are they time rich? Are they employed? Are they unemployed? Do they work office hours or do they work weekends? I mean, all of this tells us a lot about individuals. And we can then group these patterns of individuals, and from grouping that in the same way we do in medical research, we can look for correlations. And that enables us to then present that back to our clients to actually understand the customer, understand what consumers look like. And this is kind of like the Petri dish. So when we can understand what customers look like, that inspires us to innovate new types of interventions, new ways of you know, nudging an individual to behave in the way that, you know, works, you know, for the common community or the whole or for the organisation, okay? But that's where we sort of stop. You know, we create these interventions and we don't then look at the petri dish to work out who receives these interventions. And if you have a look at a lot of what government does, you know, they may do a study, may come up with some interventions, but then the next thing is they'll develop a set of rules for applying those or allocating those interventions to individuals, okay? And a rules-based approach is based on, you know, sort of macroscopic insights, based on prejudice, based on experience, which may not necessarily be optimal. So that's where we need to go back and look at what medical research has done and the concept of randomized control trials. So what we then do is we take all of the interventions that we've innovated and we start randomly allocating them to the population. And we then, what we do is we look at what actually worked and what didn't work, okay? And we actually compare this, you know, at a very microscopic scale to those very, very fine attributes that describe individual consumers, okay? And so what our algorithms are learning, they're learning that we've made an intervention randomly to an individual. Of course, when I say randomly, they have to be eligible. I mean, you don't obviously chase somebody up for a you know, a default notice payment or something when they haven't done one. But you know, there is a number of ways you can treat people who default on a payment. Okay, there may be 10 different ways. So we allocate those randomly to the population that are eligible. And in doing so, what we look at is the response of the individual and correlate that back to the very granular pattern of the individual behavior. And the algorithm is then able to learn what individual for a particular behavioral pattern is actually optimal in driving the best possible outcome, okay? And that's essentially what's a very algorithmic process and what machine learning actually does, enables us to do. And so that then enables us to give individuals a very personalized experience, one which works for them, okay? So for example, you know, if the intervention is to contact a particular agency to follow up on a matter, you know, the experience that we may give them may be one which is specifically tailored on the digital channel if they're very time poor and we deem that they may be very digitally savvy versus maybe an in-branch experience which may be for people who have more time but may not be so digitally savvy. And so that sort of level of personalization is something that comes out of that. So really in conclusion is that algorithms, data and randomized control trials, those three things together enable us to really treat people as individuals, okay, in a modern day, okay, when we have to really do things at scale, okay, and we do that by leveraging enormous amounts of data that we can collect from the various interactions that people have, you know, really across all of the channels that are available today. And so I think that's probably all I've got time for. I can go through an example if we have one, but maybe that's it for today. Thank you.